Hello, I'm Donna Cryer, founder and CEO of the Global Liver Institute, and I am proud to bring you Liver Cancer Lessons. This is part of an educational series where we bring liver cancer experts to you to answer the questions that patients and caregivers have brought to us. I am very proud that as an expert today, I have Dr. Lewis Roberts, who is professor of medicine at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota, and head of the hepatobiliary cancers laboratory there. He is also a member of the Global Liver Institute Board of Directors and our Liver Cancers Council. We are so excited that his passion for personalized medicine and individualized patient care is something that we can count on every day. Dr. Roberts, welcome.
Thank you.
So Dr. Roberts, in this liver cancer lesson, I would like to ask you about the risk factors for liver and bile duct cancers. What causes them? Are there particular diseases that are drivers for them? Please tell us about the risks for developing types of cancers.
Thanks. That's a great question. So liver cancer is important in part because globally, it is one of the major cancers that we see. Most studies that have been performed suggest that it's number six worldwide in terms of numbers of cases of cancer that are diagnosed in any particular year. And it's a pretty lethal cancer. So that in terms of number of deaths from cancer each year, it generally is in the range of number two to number four. So this is a major disease, a major cause of cancer death worldwide. Why is liver cancer so prevalent? There are four major risk factors that have been identified for liver cancer. Two of these take the form of viral infections or chronic viral infections of the liver. And these are chronic viral hepatitis B and chronic viral hepatitis C. And depending on the part of the world that a person lives in, they are typically exposed at higher risk of being exposed to one or other of these viruses. So for example, for people living in Asia or in sub-Saharan Africa, the very high rates of chronic hepatitis B in the population. And these are transmitted either from a mother to a child or after birth between children or between adults and children in a household. But chronic hepatitis B affects somewhere of the order of almost 300 million people a year. I'm sorry, 300 million people, because it's chronic. These are people who have these infections on an ongoing basis. Consequently, there are several hundred thousand people each year who develop liver cancer that is caused by chronic hepatitis B. The other virus that causes liver cancer is chronic hepatitis C virus infection. So this is a different virus, but also affects somewhere between probably 70 and 100 million people worldwide. And this also is a major cause of inflammation in the liver. It leads eventually to cirrhosis of the liver or scar tissue formation in the liver and damage to liver cells that results in the formation of cancer of the hepatocytes or the primary liver cells. So these are two of the main causes of liver cancer that are induced by viruses. The other two major risk factors for liver cancer are chronic alcohol use. Chronic alcohol use leads to the deposition of fat in the liver, a condition that we call steatosis. That fat can cause inflammation, which is called steatohepatitis, and that inflammation can eventually lead to scar tissue formation or cirrhosis, followed by the development of liver cancer. The other major cause of fat in the liver is obesity or obesity-related diabetes. Because this then leads to deposition of fat also within the liver. And we see a very similar process of what happens with alcohol use, where we see fat, then inflammation or steatohepatitis. And then from the steatohepatitis, we can have cirrhosis and the damage to the hepatocytes that leads to formation of cancer. There are other causes of chronic liver diseases that are not viral or alcohol or obesity related. Those tend to be less common, but they include inherited diseases such as hemochromatosis or alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency, which leads to a malformed type of alpha-1 antitrypsin protein. In addition, we have conditions such as primary biliary cirrhosis, which is an autoimmune condition, and other less common conditions. In terms of the other type of hepatobiliary cancer, which is the biliary tract cancers, so the biliary tract cancers affect the bile ducts, we have these subclassified into intrahepatic cholangiocarcinomas, intrahepatic bile duct cancers. Then we have the perihilar or distal, which are both considered extrahepatic bile duct cancers. The intrahepatic bile duct cancers frequently have risk factors that are actually quite similar to the risk factors that cause hepatocellular cancer. So the viral hepatitis, alcohol use, fatty liver disease, all are conditions that can predispose to intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. In addition, we have diseases that occur within the bile ducts. So primary sclerosing cholangitis, for example, is an immune-related condition that causes inflammation and scar tissue formation in the bile ducts, and that predisposes individuals to development of bile duct cancers. There are also parasites in some parts of the world that contributes to the development of bile duct cancer. So for example, there's a fancy word, clonorchis, is a type of parasite that is called a liver fluke. Another type of liver fluke is called opisthorchis. These liver flukes are found most commonly in parts of Asia, particularly Thailand, but they also can cause inflammation in the bile ducts and predispose individuals to cancers of the bile ducts. And one other important cause of liver and biliary tract cancers are toxins. And so there are toxins that can be ingested in the diet. So for example, we have dietary aflatoxins, which are fungal toxins that are ingested from fungal contamination of different foods, typically grains or peanuts, for example. And so people who are exposed to high degrees of aflatoxins because grains or peanuts are not stored or dried carefully after harvest can also have these aflatoxins that contribute to development of their liver cancers. Within the bile ducts, there's fairly strong evidence that a type of toxin that is involved in offset printing offset printing presses can also cause bile duct cancer. And there have been a number of studies, particularly from Japan, that have shown that in places where there was an offset printing press or facility where something went wrong with the ventilation, then we've had clusters of cases of bile duct cancer that occurred, presumably due to the effects of these toxins on the bile ducts.
I had no idea that there were that many diverse drivers for liver and bile duct cancers. But the primary ones that result in the hundreds of millions of cases are from hepatitis B, which now has a vaccine or has had a vaccine for quite a while, hepatitis C, which has a cure, fatty liver disease or NASH, and then, you know, a smattering of autoimmune and other rare types of disease. So in addition to the vaccine for hepatitis B and hepatitis C cures, are there things that people can be doing to reduce their risk factors for liver cancer? Certainly in NASH, you can lose weight, and until we have treatments for those, I heard that coffee was also good for you. And I like being able to tell people that there's something in their everyday lives that they're already doing that has a hepatoprotective effect. Is that true?
That's exactly right. And so as you mentioned, for hepatitis B, there's a vaccine that is used worldwide for children. In most countries, the vaccine is being used starting at about 2 to 3 months of age. And so the big push there in terms of vaccination is to encourage the deployment of what we call the birth dose of the hepatitis B vaccine, so that children receive it within 24 hours of birth, because that's been shown to be even more effective. So they'll receive the first birth dose and then subsequent additional doses with the other childhood immunizations. The other thing that has been shown to be quite effective is identifying hepatitis B in pregnant women so that they can be treated during the last stages of pregnancy. If women who have high levels of hepatitis B in their blood are treated in the last trimester of pregnancy, that substantially reduces the risk of them transmitting hepatitis B to their children. So that's a wonderful way to prevent hepatitis B induced cancer. And then of course, finally, we also, even though we don't have a cure for hepatitis B, we have treatments that can substantially suppress the levels of hepatitis B in the blood, and they reduce a person's risk of hepatitis B induced cancer. So identifying those people who have hepatitis B but don't know about it, as we say, finding the missing millions, and putting them on treatment if they meet the criteria for treatment, is an important way of reducing risk of hepatitis B-induced cancer. For hepatitis C, you mentioned we have a cure. And so again, the key is identifying, in the United States, for example, we think that as many as half of the people with chronic hepatitis C virus infection don't know they have it. So identifying the individuals who have chronic hepatitis C, so we can cure them of their chronic hepatitis C, has also been shown to substantially reduce the risk of cancer. And then there's coffee, because for almost all the studies that have been done that have examined the role of different foods or nutrients in risk of liver cancer have shown that coffee use is associated with a substantial reduction in risk of progression of liver disease, as well as reduction in risk of developing liver cancer. And how much coffee? It looks like 2 cups a day is the minimum that we see an effect from. How is it that coffee works? We don't know for sure. It seems like it's not just the caffeine itself in coffee. So if you prefer decaf coffee, it may be probably just as effective. But there's lots of other organic compounds in coffee, and some of these seem to be quite beneficial from the perspective of reducing risk of liver cancer. So this is actually the one food within the realm of liver diseases that we can encourage people to use to reduce their risk of liver disease.
Thank you, Dr. Roberts, and thank you for this liver cancer lesson.